Hi all, I have an absolutely fascinating game from the Leela test server. This is the Leela test server ID 10171, so it's different ID format, much bigger number, so 10171. This game was submitted by Enrico Caruso, and it does seem to have a theoretical novelty. I've been checking against online opening databases like chessgames.com. Let's have a look. It's within the classic most researched opening ever in chess history, the Ruy Lopez. So it's interesting to find a novelty in the Ruy Lopez. E4 from Gull 3. So Gull 3 against Leela. E5, Knight F3, Knight C6. Pretty standard stuff so far. The most trodden opening in the history of chess, the classic Ruy Lopez. A6, Bishop A4, we have Knight F6, White castles, and we have the Ruy Lopez open variation, known as sometimes the Tarash defense, Knight takes E4 within the Ruy Lopez open variation. Just taking here on E4. D4, this is well known territory so far. Now this is slightly unusual to take on D4. Because it seems as though this is potentially bad because of the e5. I think it dissuades a lot of players not to play this line. Instead, much preferred is b5. So, for example, here d5, and white closes up that e5. And this must give some comfort to black. Black has to deal with the d5 pawn, but this is very well known, and I think used in world championship matches between, say, Karpov and Kouchner, I believe. This is definitely an opening used at world championship level, this particular variation. White is thought to have a small edge, but it's no big deal. So that's the safe line known. Now we're veering into what either is beginner moves or absolute genius here. Not quite yet. It's after this move. Again, here d5 has been seen before, but I'm not sure in this position it's meant to be that good. Bishop d6 aims for basically a draw. After this, bang, bishop takes, and here, because if the king takes, it's a draw by perpetual check in this line with a perpetual check. But the thing is, white here can actually sidestep that and get a small edge with rook takes e4 check, believe it or not, and then forcing the queen off with queen d8 check. So this is a clever tactical idea, and it ends up white has a small edge here. You can see white's got the bishop pair, and also white has an extra piece, basically. So two pieces against the rook. White's thought to be slightly better. Now, as I say, this is the Ruy Lopez. This is heavily trodden territory here. So this position, d5 is known, but it's not supposed to be that great. This move now, which is played, is f5. And there are two games I found at chessgames.com with this continuation. Miller against Giblin, 2011, which was a win for white, and Rinder against Block Nakarud, 1939, which was a win for white. So they had bishop after rook e1, f5, knight takes d4. They had basically bishop c5 was played by Giblin in 2011, just looking at my monitor there. Bishop e7 was played in 1939. So quite a long way apart, only two games at chessgames.com. So is this position, does it have something? is this some sort of weird new discovery? There is a weakness of the last move on knight f3 taking d4, that the h4 square has been neglected. And it's that which actually, Leela, even though the king's totally in the center here, and it seems ridiculous to go on to the attack. It's a rule breaking move. You shouldn't really be going on to the attack if the king's still in the center. But we have queen h4. Now, that doesn't give white much time to try and exploit the king's center because of that queen f2 check possibility and taking on d4, for example. So the queen's kicked back, so it weakens some squares, though. And the queen goes to f6, which makes it annoying again to play f3 because there's queen takes d4 check here, and white can end up losing the exchange if not careful, with a big advantage to black. But here, now this position is still, I think most people would regard it as ridiculous and not worth exploration because white plays bishop takes c6, surely. Which takes the pressure off d4. This is ridiculous, right? I'm just wondering if it's because it's so ridiculous, this whole line has been totally obscured. And there's even more rule breaking as well to make this even more ridiculous now, believe it or not. You might think d takes might be useful to try, maybe castle queenside or something, but no, we have b takes, which represents starting to represent a full piece sacrifice, because f3 is going to be played with the king in the center. White does play f3, but it does weaken that diagonal. And notes that, you know, the g3 had weakened some light squares. We're weakening a bit the dark squares a bit. So we see bishop c5, and actually here is interesting theoretically. White supports the knight with c3. It seems as though, this is already very interesting, you can check the detailed PGN in the pinned comments. It seems bishop e3 can run into f4. Example, g takes, knight d6. This is very, very scary for black with the king in the center still. So look at this tactic. Knight e7 check. It turns out here that black might actually be okay. It might actually be an even position. You can see that the pawns are shattered. The bishop might be quite handy. It's not that bad. Even though black is two pawns down, there seems to be a lot of compensation, making it dynamically an equal position. So it seems this bishop e3 does run into f4. Another idea, say bishop f2. This is a full piece set concept now, d5, which most certainly obscures the whole thing, because who would want to give up a piece here like this? What is the compensation? In fact, there does seem to be compensation here. For example, c3, bishop d6. What is actually white doing? Like, Leela has got the potential form pawn, T-H-O-R-N, and she's also got the two bishops trained against the king in a way. And I'll give you an example. D takes e4 makes it actually difficult for white to take on e4 without getting smashed. Here, for example, queen takes e4, fg, and white actually gets smashed because now there's a threat of queen f1 check, mating. Just to put that on the board to show you, that's a standard mating pattern. So say white tries to parry this mating pattern by playing knight d2. So we're taking on e4, fg, bishop g, bishop h3, so threatening queen f1. So say knight d2. This position here, after check, is very dangerous for white after rook f6 with the idea of rook h6. So for example, here, taking and then check wins the white queen with an advantage to black. So basically, this, I would say, increases the potential obscurity of this whole thing. In fact, that maybe it was also thought bishop e3 was simple and strong. So let's go with c3, which doesn't make use of the bishop. So the piece is still on the first row. Let's assume this is a reasonable move. This is a full piece sack. Queen g6. Is this a new concept? I don't know what it is. There isn't any decent games in chess based live book with this. So it makes it kind of exciting. It's like it is like a scientific discovery or something. It's in the most trodden opening of all time, the Ruy Lopez, in the open variation, the terrace variation. What is this? You might ask. White plays b4 here. I mean, we can transpose. We can try to take the piece here. Say b4, bishop e7. It seems white might have queen a4, which seems to pin down against d5, basically. That you might be wondering why queen a4. This is my analysis here. It seems as though, in theory, white should have a big advantage. In theory. But I'm only checking these with standard engines. There might be a better way of playing this, but it seems as though in theory white has a big advantage there. So queen a4 might be a critical test of the whole thing, because one justification here that I could imagine is basically, if d5 is allowed, it's an aggressive pawn chain, which means that once black castles, there's the f file, there's the bishop coming to h3 here on the light squares. Basically, it's like this aggressive pawn chain is like an open invitation to get the party going with all the pieces attacking the king. It's very aggressively set up for the pieces to be able to have a party on the king side, essentially. And I've seen this concept before. I remember on TV there was this game, a rapid game between Michael Adams playing white, Nigel Short black, and Nigel with the French defense. He sacked like a piece to get a very aggressive pawn chain with spearheaded with e4, and later he got a really vicious attack and managed to win that in brilliant style. So sometimes the aggressive pawn chain is like an open invitation to attacking potential attacking pieces later. So is it worth an entire piece sacrifice to get this aggressive pawn chain? So we'll go back to the game now. So b4, so after queen g6, b4 was played first before taking on e4, bishop e7. And now, of course, unpinning the knight, so there's no time for queen a4. So f takes e4, and we get this situation where, what do we believe this? do we believe that this is worth a piece? Maybe white should try and restrain black against d5 here. I mean, a lot of things need investigating here. White plays knight d2, and now black gets in this d5, which is what I'm saying, this aggressive pawn chain. As I say, once black castles, there's light squares to tap into because of the cheeky queen h4 earlier, which, as I say, the whole thing would have been plunged into obscurity because it's as though black was playing like a total beginner. But in fact, pawns don't go backwards, so the earlier weakness creation seems to marry well with the piece sacrifice here to get a spearheaded aggressive pawn chain here, which the light square bishop can at least enjoy. So we see here knight 2 to b3, and black doesn't even castle h5. Why not just activate the rook? So g3 is also a bit vulnerable. A pawn has been lost away from white's king shield to take that piece earlier, and this is pawn chain is already feeling some pressure. Bishop f4, now black castles, threatening rook takes f4. Queen d2 was played holding the bishop. It seems as though bishop takes is something to investigate. Bishop h3, king h1. It seems as though, for my analysis, this might be already a very dangerous position for white, and black might be able to at least win the queen. It seems if queen e1 is needed. I mean, for example, there are probably things like e3 and queen e4 check. So queen e1 turns up on the books, just giving up the queen here as the move. Which gives black at least an equal position after e3 now, even position. So this is really fascinating stuff. But queen d2 was played, rook f7. So trying to hold the fort and not allow any infiltration, I guess, the queen d2 move. Now, it's not really possible to take on c7 because of bishop g5 here, hitting the queen and hitting the bishop. If the bishop retreats, then we're snapping that off and the pin pawn, we're winning a piece. So we see here king h1. So now, okay, this might be on. If white's really interested in this too, I doubt it now, because there's other concerns. Bishop g4, potentially. The knight's holding f3 at the moment, though. We see knight a5. In fact, taking here might be better just to double the rooks, by the way. So white didn't indulge that extra material gain. White played knight a5, going for c6, which would weaken e5. You can see a knight coming to e5 would fork queen and rook. Black reacts now with c5. So now we have knight dc6, so threatening knight e5 among other things. On b takes, bishop takes, this position is interesting, of course, but it seems as though, I'm just giving you an example continuation where black can take on d4, basically get this check in, and should actually be okay in these lines with e3, because then if this looks okay. If queen takes e3, then, by the way, then there's bishop takes d5. You'll see all these variations in that pinned comment, the pinned PGN, if you want to check them out. So basically, white didn't take on c5. We have knight dc6. And now we have bishop d6, sort of addressing the e5 concern. And it's too slow, I guess, to take on d5 here, because the bishop takes f4 and then bishop f3 check mating. So it's unpalatable to take that. We have bishop takes d6. The check isn't used here, though. C takes. Now we have b takes c5. Now, whilst this d pawn is holding against knight e5, black actually likes that, doesn't want to do anything with that pawn at the moment, and just plays h4. As I say, these pieces are not really helping the king. This spearheading pawn structure is letting the attacking pieces enjoy attacking, basically, with a kind of free hand here for the moment. We have h4. If d takes c5, then that weakens the e5 square, knight e5, forking queen and rook. And this position is just a big advantage for white. There's no attack, no nothing there. So we have h4 being played. Queen takes d5, and now rook e8. And this is already really dangerous, by the way. Now, bishop f3 is already really dangerous as well. This position with king h7, for example, like this, with queen h5, black has a big edge here. The attack is very dangerous in this position because of hg possibilities and queen h1 or rook f6 to g6, which is reflective of the main game continuation now. But Leela wants to support e4 here first. After takes, now we see queen h5. So there's ideas, bishop f3 and hg, and also bringing a rook in. So we have here rook e3, check, king g1, h takes g3. Yeah, the bishop check is actually interfering with the rook, helping to defend here. So now if hg, then queen h1, winning the rook is a big advantage for black. So we have queen takes g3, and now a rook left. You know, rook g6 is now threatened. So we have knight d4, rook g6, yes, and black's now winning that queen. And this is a very good position, as you might expect. Taking on c5 now. This is diabolical because it's actually forking the rook and knight as well. basically, it is a diabolical position now, and black's just queen against rook. It's trivially winning now with this passed a pawn. Game attack carries on a bit until here. So obviously, just queening. Yeah, is convincing. So I don't know if this game is really representative of something that needs to be checked out, a theoretical opening novelty. As I say, I've done my, you know, brief checking with Chess Games Common and Chess Based Livebook, and these lines with taking on d4 and f5 is just basically what, you know, lower rated players would play, not with any amazing idea follow up. But it seems that the same moves which provoke weaknesses like g3 can actually be the start of a spectacular knight sacrifice, intuitive knight sacrifice, by the evidence of this game, which appears to be very good compensation potentially. What I'm unsure of myself are the lines with queen a4 trying to stop this aggressive pawn formation actually happening. Because once that does happen, you know, intuitively, it's like an open, it's like makes it invitation friendly for the party of attacking pieces just to build up against the white king, as we saw here. So I don't know, this is really fascinating. Let me know if you really think this is an interesting opening novelty, this within the open variation of the Ruy Lopez, the Tarash, in brackets, the Tarash defense, as it's sometimes referred to. So Ruy Lopez open novelty or madness? Comments, questions, like, shares appreciated. Thanks very much.